So I'd like to share an excerpt from America Was Promises with you. And there is an answer. There is Spain, Austria, Poland, China, Bohemia. There are dead men in the pits in all those countries. Their mouths are silent, but they speak. They say, the promises are theirs who take them. Listen, brothers, generation, listen. You have heard these words. Believe it. Believe the promises and theirs who take them. Believe unless we take them for ourselves, others will take them for the use of others. Believe unless we take them for ourselves, all of us, one here, another there, men, not man, people, not the people, hands, mouths, arms, eyes, not syllables. Believe unless we take them for ourselves, others will take them, not for us, for others. Believe unless we take them for ourselves now, soon, by the clock before tomorrow, others will take them, not for now, for longer. Listen. Brothers, generation, companions of leaves of the sun of the slow evenings, companions of the many days, all of them, listen, believe, believe the speaking dead, believe the journey is our journey. Oh, believe, the signals were for us, the signs, the birds by night, the breaking surf. Believe, America is promises to take. America is promises to us. To take them brutally with love, but take them. Oh, believe this.
Patterns. I walk down the garden path, and all the daffodils are blowing, and the bright blue squills. I walk down the patterned garden path in my stiff brocaded gown, with my powdered hair and jeweled fan. I too am a rare pattern as I wander down the garden path. My dress is richly figured, and the train makes a pink and silver stain on the gravel, and the thrift of the borders. Just a plate of current fashion, tripping by in high-heeled ribbon shoes, not a softness anywhere about me, only whalebone and brocade. And I sink on a seat in the shade of a lime tree, for my passion wars against the stiff brocade. The daffodils and squills flutter in the breeze as they please. And I weep, for the lime tree is in blossom, and one small flower has dropped upon my bosom. And the plashing of water drops in the marble fountain comes down the garden path. The dripping never stops. Underneath my stiffened gown is the softness of a woman bathing in a marble basin, a basin in the midst of hedges grown so thick she cannot see her lover hiding, but she guesses he is near, and the sliding of the water seems the stroking of a dear hand upon her. What is summer in a fine brocaded gown? I should like to see it lying in a heap upon the ground, all the pink and silver crumpled up on the ground. I would be the pink and silver as I ran along the path, and he would stumble after, bewildered by my laughter. I should see the sun flashing from his sword hilt and the buckles on his shoes. I would choose to lead him in a maze along the patterned path, a bright and laughing maze for my heavy-booted lover, till he caught me in the shade, and the buttons of his waistcoat bruised my body as he clasped me, aching, melting, unafraid. With the shadows of the leaves and the sun drops, and the plopping of the water drops all about us in the open afternoon. I am very like to swoon with the weight of this brocade, for the sun shifts through the shade. Underneath the fallen blossom in my bosom is a letter I have hid. It was brought to me this morning by a rider from the Duke. Madam, we regret to inform you that Lord Hartwell died in action Thursday tonight. As I read it in the white morning sunlight, the letters squirmed like snakes. Any answer, madam? Said my footman. No, I told him. See that the messenger takes some refreshment. No, no answer. And I walked into the garden, up and down the patterned paths, in my stiff, correct brocade. The blue and yellow flowers stood up proudly in the sun, each one. I stood upright too, held rigid to the pattern by the stiffness of my gown. Up and down I walked, up and down. In a month, he would have been my husband. In a month here, under this line, we would have broke the pattern, he for me and I for him, he as colonel, I as lady, on this shady seat. He had a whim that sunlight carried blessing, and I answered, it shall be as you have said. Now he is dead. In summer and in winter, I shall walk up and down the patterned garden paths in my stiff brocaded gown. The squills and daffodils will give place to pillared roses and to asters and to snow. I shall go up and down in my gown, gorgeously arrayed, boned and stayed, and the softness of my body will be guarded from embrace by each button, hook, and lace. For the man who should loose me is dead, fighting with the Duke in Flanders in a pattern called the war. Christ, what are patterns for?
Next to, of course, God, America, I love you, land of the pilgrims and so forth. Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early, my country 'tis of centuries come and go and are no more. What of it? We should worry in every language, even deaf and dumb, the sons that claim your glorious name by gory, by jingle, by gee, by gosh, by gum. Why talk of beauty? What could be more beautiful than these heroic, happy dead who rush like lions to the roaring slaughter? They did not stop to think. They died instead. Then shall the voice of liberty be mute? He spoke and drank rapidly a glass of water. The levels of irony are so reminiscent of MacLeish. Another poem that I didn't, is not listed on your program, but I have to read it because it also reminds me a lot of a poem by MacLeish, a lot of poems actually by MacLeish, one specifically called November, which is thoughts about what it's like to be growing old and that sort of thing. And this is a poem. Cummings didn't title his poems, but first line, and I'll just continue to read it. A wind has blown the rain away, and blown the sky away, and all the leaves away, and the trees stand. I think I too have known autumn too long. And what have you to say, wind, wind, wind? Did you love somebody? And have you the petal of somewhere in your heart pinched from dumb summer? Oh, crazy daddy of death, dance cruelly for us and start the last leaf whirling in the final brain of air. Let us, as we have seen, see doom's integration. A wind has blown the rain away and the leaves and the sky, and the trees stand. The trees stand. The trees suddenly wait against the moon's face.
The Love Song of J. Alfred Prufrock. The poem is prefaced by a quote from Dante's Inferno, which says, in which the speaker says that if he believed that anyone would hear what he had to say, he'd shut up. The speaker in this poem is speaking largely to himself, and there's thought that the you and I could refer to Eliot himself. All right, let us go then, you and I, when the evening is spread out against the sky like a patient etherized upon a table. Let us go through certain half-deserted streets, the muttering retreats of restless nights in one-night cheap hotels and sawdust restaurants with oyster shells. Streets that follow like an insidious argument with insidious intent to lead you to an overwhelming question. Do not ask, what is it? Let us go and make our visit. In the room, the women come and go talking of Michelangelo. The yellow fog that ruts its back upon the window panes, the yellow smoke that ruts its muzzle on the window panes, licked its tongue into the corners of the evening, lingered upon the pools that stand in drains, let fall upon its back the soot that falls from chimneys, slipped by the terrace, made a sudden leap, and seeing that it was a soft October night, curled once about the house and went to sleep. And indeed, there will be time for the yellow smoke that slides along the street, rubbing its back upon the window panes. There will be time to prepare a face to meet the faces that it meets. There will be time to murder and create, and time for all the works and days of hands that lift and drop a question on your plate. Time for you, and time for me, and time yet for 100 indecisions, and time for 100 visions and revisions before the taking of toast and tea. In the room, the women come and go talking with Michelangelo. And indeed, there will be time to wonder, do I dare? And do I dare? Time to turn back and descend the stair with a bald spot in the middle of my hair. They will say, my, how his hair is growing thin. The morning comes, my collar mounting firmly to the chin, my necktie rich and modest, but asserted by a simple pin. They will say, oh, but how his arms and legs are thin. Do I dare disturb the universe? In a minute, there is time for decisions and revisions which a minute will reverse. For I've known them all, have known the evenings, mornings, afternoons. I have measured out my life with coffee spoons. I know the voice is dying with a dying fall beneath the music from a farther room, so how should I presume? And I've known the eyes already, known them all, the eyes that fix you in a formulated phrase. And when I am formulated, sprawling on a pin, when I am pinned and wriggling on the wall, then how should I begin to spit out all the butt ends of my days and ways? How should I presume? And I've known the arms already, known them all, arms that are braceleted and white and bare, but in the lamplight down with light brown hair. Is it perfume from a dress that makes me so digress? Arms that lie along the table or wrap around a shawl, and should I then presume, and how should I begin? Shall I say I have gone at dusk through narrow streets and watched the smoke that rises from the pipes of lonely men in shirt sleeves leaning out of windows? I should have been a pair of ragged claws scuttling across the floors of silent seas. In the afternoon, the evening, sleep so peacefully, smoothed by long fingers, asleep, tired, or malingers stretched on the floor here beside you and me. Should I, after teas and cakes and ices, have the strength to force the moment to its crisis? But though I have wept and prayed, though I have seen my head grown slightly bald, brought in upon a platter, I am no prophet, and here's no great matter, and have seen the moment of my greatness flicker, I have seen the eternal footman hold my coat and snicker. Short, I was afraid. And would it have been worth it? After all, after the cups, the marmalade, and the tea, among the porcelain, among such talk of you and me, would it have been worthwhile to have bitten off the matter with a smile, to have squeezed the universe into a ball, to roll it towards some overwhelming question, to say, I am Lazarus, come back from the dead, come back to tell you all, I shall tell you all. If one setting up a pillow by her head should say, that's not what I meant at all. That's not it at all. And would it have been worth it after all? Would it have been worthwhile after the sunsets and the dooryards and the sprinkled streets, after the novels, after the teacups, after the skirts that trail along the floor, and this and so much more? It's impossible to say just what I mean. But as if a magic lantern threw the nerves and pattern on a screen, would it have been worthwhile if one settling a pillow of, or throwing off a shawl and turning toward the window should say, "That's not it at all. It's not what I meant at all. No, I am not Prince Hamlet, or was meant to be. I am an attendant lord, one that will do to swallow progress, start a scene or two, advise the prince, no doubt an easy tool, deferential, glad to be of use, politic, cautious, and meticulous, full of high sentence, but a bit obtuse, at times indeed almost ridiculous, almost at times the fool. I grow old. I grow old, I shall wear the bottoms of my trousers rolled. Shall I part my hair behind? Do I dare to eat a peach? I shall wear white flannel trousers and walk upon the beach. I've heard the mermaids singing each to each. I do not think that they will sing to me. I've seen them riding seaward on the waves, combing the white hair of the waves blown back when the wind blows the water white and black. We have lingered in the chambers of the sea by sea girls wreathed with seaweed, red and brown, till human voices wake us and we drown."
Mending wall. Something there is that doesn't love a wall, that sends the frozen groundswell under it and spills the upper boulders in the sun and makes gaps even two can pass abreast. The work of hunters is another thing. I have come after them and made repair where they have left not one stone on a stone, but they would have the rabbit out of hiding to please the yelping dogs. The gaps I mean, no one has seen them made or heard them made, but at spring mending time we find them there. I let my neighbor know beyond the hill, and on a day we meet to walk the line and set the wall between us once again. We keep the wall between us as we go, to each the boulders that have fallen to each, and some are lobes and some so nearly balls we have to use a spell to make them balance. Stay where you are until our backs are turned. We wear our fingers rough with handling them. Oh, just another kind of outdoor game, one on a side. It comes to little more. There where it is, we do not need the wall. He is all pine and I am apple orchard. My apple trees will never get across and eat the cones under his pines, I tell him. He only says, "Good fences make good neighbors." Spring is the mischief in me, and I wonder if I could put a notion in his head. Why do they make good neighbors? Isn't it where there are cows? But here there are no cows. Before I built a wall, I'd ask to know what I was walling in or walling out, and to whom I was like to give offense. Something there is that doesn't love a wall, that wants it down. I could say elves to him, but it's not elves exactly, and I'd rather he said it for himself. I see him there, bringing a stone grasped firmly by the top in each hand, like an old stone savage armed. He moves in darkness, as it seems to me, not of woods only in the shade of trees. He will not go beyond his father's saying, and he likes having thought of it so well. He says again, "Good fences make good neighbors."
This is Roman numeral number 9. It's no use raising a shout. No, honey, you can cut that right out. I don't want any more hugs. Make me some fresh tea. Fetch me some rugs. Here I am, here are you. Well, what does it mean? What are we going to do? A long time ago, I told my mother I was leaving home to find another. I never answered her letter, but I never found a better. Here I am, here are you, but what does it mean? What are we going to do? It wasn't always like this. Perhaps it wasn't, but it is. Put the car away. When life fails, what's the good of going to Wales? Here am I. Here are you. But what does it mean? What are we going to do? In my spine, there was a base, and I knew the general's face, but they've severed all the wires, and I can't tell what the general desires. Here am I, here are you, but what does it mean? What are we going to do? In my veins, there is a wish and a memory of a fish. When I lie crying on the floor, it says, you've often done this before. Here am I, here are you, but what does it mean? What are we going to do? A bird used to visit this shore. It isn't going to come anymore. I've come a very long way to prove no land, no water, no love. Here am I, here are you, but what does it mean? What are we going to do? And this is a few words that MacLeish wrote in the back of this book. As far as I know, there was no connection, whatever, but just see what you think. There is everything. There is the wife who is loyal with much love. There are the children, beautiful, of young bodies. But there is also this other, which is not. And there is, therefore, nothing for the lack of the making, the existence of all that for which it is made is nothing.
English Cocker, Old and Blind. With what painful deliberation he comes down the stair. At the edge of each step, one paw suspended in air and distrust. Does he thus stand on a final edge of the world? Sometimes he stands thus and will not budge, with a choking, soft whimper, while monstrous blackness is whirled inside his head, and outside, too, the world whirling in blind vertigo. But if your hand merely touches his head, old faith comes flooding back and the paw descends. His trust is infinite in you, who are, in his eternal night, only a frail scent subject to the whim of wind, or only a hand held close to him with a dog biscuit, or in a sudden burst of temper, the force that jerks that goddamned accursed little brute off your bed. But remember how you last saw him hesitate in his whirling dark, one paw suspended above the abyss at the edge of the stair, and remember that musical whimper, and how then aware of a sudden sweet heart stab, you knew in him the kinship of all flesh defined by a halting paradigm.
A sketch. Into the lower right square of the window frame there came with scalloped flight a goldfinch lit upon the dead branch of a pine, shining, and then was gone. Tossed in a double arc, upward into the thatched and cross-hatched pine needle dark. Briefly, as fresh drafts stirred the tree, he dulled and gleamed and seemed more cold than bird. Then dodging down, returned in a new light, his perch, a birch twig, where he burned in the sun's broadside ray. Some seed pinched in his bill, yet still he did not stay. But into a leaf-choked pane, changeful as an even in heaven, even in Saturn's reign, tunneled away and hid, and then, but I cannot well tell you all that he did. It was like glancing at rough sketches tacked on a wall, and all so less than enough, of gold on beaten wing, I could not choose that one be done as the finished thing. The second poem I chose to read is He Was, which comes from a collection of poetry published in 1950 called Ceremony and Other Poems. He was a brown old man with a green thumb. I can remember the squeak on stones of his hoe, the chug, choke, and high madrigal wheeze of the spray cart bumping below the sputtery leaves of the apple trees. But he was all but dumb. Who filled some quarter of the day with sound all of my childhood long? For all I heard of all his labors, I can now recall never a single word until he went in the dead of fall to the drowsy underground. Having planted a young orchard with so great care in the last year that none was lost, and May aroused them all, the leaves laying the land's praise with the livening day, clay, and the found voice of his buried hands rose in the sparrowy air.
Commerger wrote this at the height of McCarthyism in the early 1950s, and it was published in Harper's Magazine. It is easier to say what loyalty is not than what it is. It is not conformity. It is not passive acquiescence in the status quo. It is not preference for everything American over everything foreign. It is not an ostrich-like ignorance of other countries and other institutions. It is not the indulgence in ceremony, a flag salute, an oath of allegiance, a fervent verbal declaration. It is not a particular creed, a particular version of history, a particular body of economic practices, a particular philosophy. It is a tradition, an ideal, and a principle. It is a willingness to subordinate every private advantage for the larger good. It is an appreciation of the rich and diverse contributions that can come from the most varied sources. It is allegiance to the traditions that have guided our greatest statesmen and women and inspired our most eloquent poets, the traditions of freedom, equality, democracy, tolerance, the tradition of the higher law, of experimentation, cooperation, and pluralism. It is a realization that America was born of revolt, flourished on dissent, became great through experimentation.